Hello, this is a Wizard of Ox workshop. Today's theme is, what is oxalate? And is this something that I should worry about? Be aware that the info in this video is for educational purposes only and does not constitute medical advice.
Oxalate is a toxic compound, regardless of where it's coming from. It can be found in your diet via plant foods. It can also be coming into your system through supplements that you might be taking. This is exogenous oxalate, which means coming from the outside in. We all make a certain amount of oxalate as part of our metabolism, and this is normal. However, if we are having issues like with our B6 and are perhaps having some level of deficiency, this may tip our metabolism towards making more oxalate. That oxalate that comes from the inside is called endogenous oxalate.
In its crystal form, where oxalate is insoluble, oxalate may irritate tissues and can be taken into cells. In its insoluble form, it easily interferes with the movement of other important molecules like sulfate and ones that change pH like bicarbonate. Interfering with how iodine is handled is why it often causes thyroid problems. Sulfate is used as an on-off switch for hormones and for important processes that help nerve function. We know now that oxalate has specific transporters that change where it is taken all over the body, and that's why it can affect so many different systems. The inflammasome is a bit of a sensor, like you might have in your hallway that would sense the presence of intruders. It reacts the same way to infections as it does to chemistry changes like pH and crystals. Exposure to things like oxalate and the uric acid that is seen in gout can turn on inflammation and pain through the inflammasome. We sometimes use certain supplements that are inflammasome inhibitors to calm down that activation. Humans don't have any enzymes that break down oxalate, and that's why we cannot digest it. In our intestines, we have a specialized set of microbes that eat oxalate to protect us from oxalate, but they may be killed by antibiotics. Getting rid of oxalate is no longer the solitary domain of a bacterium called Oxalobacter firmigenes, and it is a gut microbe that actually requires oxalate to live. And the scientists thought that was the whole deal, and it ended up not being true. So once oxalate gets in our blood, we have no way to get it besides secretion.
So how can oxalate affect us? Well, it could change your gut flora. It strips you of minerals. It binds to minerals in foods, and since it's bound, it's no longer available for your body to use. Can cause pain and inflammation. Can also cause changes to your metabolism and affect your energy. Remember that with oxalate, the poison is in the dose, and that oxalate accumulates in the body. This can affect anyone and can especially affect folks after antibiotic use.
How could you recognize it if you have an oxalate issue? Well, like it's been explained, you could have some pain and inflammation all over the place. Floaters or eye issues, digestive troubles, rashes that itch or don't itch, tinnitus, which is that little sound that ding coming out of your ears, mood issues, anxiety, and also difficulties in sleep. But it could be many different things, as we will explain.
Our project on oxalate began about 17 years ago. And it began based on research about a genetic disease called primary hyperoxaluria. In that disease, a liver with a gene defect will pump out oxalate until the liver is removed and replaced by a transplant. Doctors described their patients having periodic severe symptoms that occurred as the oxalate that had been stored in the body left their tissues, exiting through the blood and also through urine. Back then, our project did not know if that situation would also happen when people reduced dietary oxalate. After a long habit of eating very high levels of dietary oxalate, and maybe that's you, this involves getting rid of oxalate that was absorbed into the body in the past. These symptoms ended up a very common experience. Since the scientists had never named this, we called it dumping, because oxalate seems to create a big mess all over the body body as it dumped out of places that it had been hiding. Now it was leaving obvious tracks as it let us know where it created havoc on its way out. We learned to recognize dumping by its sudden onset after you started reducing oxalate, and it often affected several areas at once. In fact, a recent poll we did on trying low oxalates found out that those symptoms were fairly evenly spread out, and so it's really hard to predict. Some people had urogenital symptoms or odd visual symptoms like crusty eyes in the morning or floaters or even digestive upset. For some people, that involved constipation, and for others, diarrhea, total opposites. So some people described odd skin rashes all over the body. Others described respiratory issues like excess phlegm or even asthma. Some people experienced circulatory issues like bulging blood vessels or inflamed blood vessels that doctors might call libido reticularis. Some people had nervous system issues like anxiety and depression. Which symptoms people experienced were not necessarily the same each time. And that's really important to know too. If you had tested urinary or plasma oxalate at any of these times when you had this dumping phenomenon, those levels would be elevated compared to your normal.
If this sounds like you, the question is, what do you do? The key thing here is that you need to understand what kind of oxalate intake you may have in order to lower it slowly. So we recommend that you join one of the Trying Low Oxalate support groups, which you can find on Facebook and you can find on Groups.io. There you will get information on how much oxalate could be in your diet. From that, you can calculate your current levels based on the test data that is kept by the Trying Low Oxalates group. Once you understand how much oxalate you are taking in, then you can develop a plan to gradually lower your intake. We do mean slowly. You can begin by starting to adjust your diet maximum 10% a week. But the higher the oxalate intake that you have been regularly on, the more likely you have to go perhaps even more slowly than that. This will vary according to the individual and also how your health has been impacted. So the more your health has been impacted, the more likely you want to go slowly. And when dumping starts, and it will, and that's not a bad thing. You need to get this oxalate out. But when it starts, you may have an exacerbation of your symptoms, and then you may want to reduce even more slowly. So this is not a sprint. This is a marathon. You go slowly, you go carefully, and you respect your body's homeostasis and whatever resilience you have, you're trying to protect it. You may need supplements as part of this journey. They should be customized to your individual situation and chemistry and adjusted as you change.
By now, you might be wondering, what exactly can I eat? I'm here to tell you, we're all here to tell you, that you can lower your oxalate and still eat nutritiously and not sacrifice taste. It is possible, and we're here to tell you, you can be a low oxalate foodie.
If you enjoyed this video, please like it and subscribe and join us for further discussions on many topics around lowering oxalate. Thank you for now and see you very soon.